thing, I guess. Or rather, let's review some things. So each of your characters was involved in an assassination mission. All of you survived. So good job. And for, I'd say, all of you, actually, your partner survived. So also, I mean, good job, unless you wanted them dead, in which case, like, you can correct that at some point. Also.
Your cat has the smallest meow.
Oh, God. Now when you resize a token, it, like, shrinks up or down in real time. I really wasn't prepared for that. It's really weird. Just gonna have to live with it.
I think it's ominous that for once we just have a black screen.
It's the end, it's fine.
Yeah, that's okay. What's the problem?
Okay, we definitely did not give... It's fine. This will be go fine.
No, we did good. Thumbs up. We didn't do good, did we?
You're fine. All right, let's get down to basics. Do you defeat the hunt?
Yeah.
I think everything's okay. Not sure. Doing just quick last minute checks. Is anyone, no one's like having any technical difficulties, correct? Like nothing is weird or broken so far?
Not that I can tell, but we are, I don't know what we're supposed to be seeing.
Just a black screen with text.
Okay, then yes.
I see the red and orange screen for some reason.
I see the black screen, so.
It's only me. No, like red and orange city.
Oh, so you don't see like the filter on the, like the with the graphical effect.
Well, I see like ash effect and. I don't know what you mean. All I know is I don't see a black screen. That's all.
Okay. That's fine. Let's just get to it, I guess. Each one of you was involved in an assassination mission. But two of you in particular... Ice Peak and Blue were towards the end of your mission. You ran into a woman named Havahedge Pantacritor, who everyone just immediately assumed is a fake name. She and her son, Tommy Lee, were connected to the president. She is the president's mistress. Your mission in real time was happening much like it wasn't happening quite as simultaneously as everyone else's. And it's definitely like a quick enough jaunt to for someone in a private plane or a boat to get back to the mainland Vladivostok. So after your mission is completed, what do you do with Havahedge? A voltage. You can either send her on her way to the president, or you can personally hold her. She is not exactly, as far as you can tell, a superpowered combatant, and doesn't seem to want to fight you. That is up to you how you guys want to do that. Putting you sort of, you can either return to your friends with her on, you know, from the Isle of Doma, return back to Vladivostok, or what is it that you two would do after the mission is complete and all the elder drinking songs have been sung?
We do know about Rivers as well, I assume?
Somewhat. Or
the chief?
Yeah, you know the chief is involved in all this. I mean, you could communicate with him, call him up if you want. Obviously, you have his number.
Yeah, I would suppose that would be the next step, as long as seems okay, Blue, yes?
Does it seem like the right move, Blue?
Oh, sorry. Yes, that sounds fine. I was AFK for a second, sorry.
Oh, no problem. Okay, so getting the chief on the line is not a problem. He will pick up, though his voice on the line sounds like the connection is starting to be, it's like a little bit shaky.
What? This is Icepeak? Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, chief.
Reception. Good. Sucks. What do you need? Is everything okay?
Mission successful? We have President's mistress and son.
Projections, statistics, send to mainland. Sound? Okay.
I cannot understand you, Chief.
Yeah, your phone would show, like, you're using as Uzeek, correct?
Yeah.
It's a regular Uzeek, yeah. You have, like, one bar.
Maybe I'll talk to some of the Doma people about better connection out of, secretive connection out of here.
Speaking to, we'll say, Nyasha.
Yeah, she's the most likely to know.
Nyasha, I regret to inform you, our phones are having problem. Must be some kind of thing.
She shows you hers. I mean, he's new, so it's not exactly a piece of shit. Still under contract.
I understand difficulties, I believe. Does it have something to do with the stars falling?
Yeah, I am not a scientist, though I appreciate you at least humoring me and assuming I would know. I suppose things happening in space affect things here on the planet, so it makes sense. Though none of them are falling here, so I should be grateful. Not the kind of fireworks I want for our celebration, though.
Well, they have... Yes, I suppose not, though. I have seen some fall during battle. I did not have much time to pay attention to it.
Are you needing to get back to your friends? I assume you do not want to stay.
The call says to come back to, well, what I could understand, may wish us to come back to mainland.
You know, I have never really been gifted in the flow. I am still novice, like baby or something. Embarrassing as it might be. But even I think that there is something on the horizon. This is no small thing that you and Blue have done. No small thing at all. Masha. Right. And you. You have done so much. But there is still probably more to do.
Speaking of, she points at Havohead. This is, I have heard, the side piece of President.
I am also not good with flow. I am still learning tides go in and tides go out. But yes, that seems to be the flow of it, she says, with a slight up nod toward the woman in question.
I think I have seen her on TV or something. Ugh. Well, in any case, what can we do for you to help you with your mission?
I would need better communication with my superiors, though I do not suppose it would be good to leave her here.
No, probably not. Oof. I don't do well with this type of Russian. Tell you what. We'll help you to maybe figure out something. I assume you'll be needing a boat to get back to.
Well, some of us will. Have you seen a man with no shirt?
Ah, the big guy.
Yes, Kingfisher is his name.
I have not. After everything happened in the Golden Love started to burn down, he and the little spiky ball, kind of cute, by the way.
Oh, extremely cute.
Seemed to have gone on their way. Of course, there were some strange men that also came and picked up weirdos. The, triplets that aren't triplets.
Where have you seen these men?
Good question. Their nondescript uniforms told me that I didn't know who they worked with. I assumed at first Dorobo was coming to pick them up, but they did not seem too happy to be taken away. So maybe their corporate overlords are tired of them or something. Either way, the big guy and the little guy, they're somewhere. Maybe still swimming around the island, trying to see if there's anyone else they can help. Storms were pretty rough for a while there.
They have contacts that I need for, at least I would hope. They were sent here by rivers, or at least... No, never mind. It is... Have you seen them of late, last place?
Big guy and little guy?
Or nondescript people, but I don't have much time to investigate. I must get back in contact with my... to see if my mission was successful in other areas.
Well, we can have people take a look for them, but, it's not the first time weird government types have ever snuck around the island and then people have disappeared. They kind of went in and out of here pretty often because of Dorobo's investments with the Seven Nation Army. More than one covert agent here and there, you know. We'll take a look.
Have so Dorobo directly has been this? Well, I have seen them disappear. People, has this happened to previous?
Yeah, here and there. You seem surprised or something. You know these shady corporations that work with military groups, especially as big as the Seven Nation Army. They get involved in things.
It has been under new management recently. I was hoping the management was different, but they never are.
Same shit, a different day. I think that is English saying. If you need contact, we will work on the radio thing too. With the storms clearing up, maybe there is chance that we could get strong connection. Or somebody could try to dredge up one of the old fiber optic cables. Yikes. Yeah, there's some good swimmers, but these waters have been rough.
I may be capable of such things.
Yeah, I suppose you actually are more qualified than most people here. Don't let them hear you say that, though. Everyone's a proud swimmer. You know that, of course. She folds her arms.
Well, the breathing underwater gives me unfair advantage.
What happens to, she kind of, like, lowers her hand to the ground. There was other little boy that was not cute.
Yes, he has his own transportation.
I guess some kids learn to drive faster than others.
Ooh, fly.
She kind of low whistles and scratches the back of her head. Shit, now I feel like an unaccomplished adult. I don't even parallel park well.
You run the city better than I do.
Because I do it at all, you lazy. She kind of like waves you off. Hard not to fall into old habits.
That is okay. I am doing my best not to make you squirm either.
She kind of points off towards the horizon. I am confused. And then she like puts her fists on her hips. The sunrise is not supposed to happen for a little bit of time. Why is there bright light over there? That looks like a fire, or she kind of squints. Some kind of explosion?
Is it not Dorbo being lit on fire by Blue, or is this something else?
Oh no, it's a different thing. A much bigger light. What she actually is pointing out is the beginning of what looks like a... The only way to describe it is the Aurora Borealis. At this time of year, this location, located entirely over Vladivostok. Magnetic lines of this great blue luminescent light are beginning to etch themselves into the dark air, giving it a very strange glow.
Beautiful. I must share with my little light. So I'll go find Blue.
I bet I'm probably nearby.
Sure. Blue, you also see this in the distance. There are these ribbons of light kind of etching themselves over the dark night sky. Just kind of undulating, winding.
Is that the Aurora Borealis?
I am told it is unusual for this time of year.
Yeah, I figured. What's going on?
In the distance, as you're looking towards the Aurora Borealis, you can also see that there is a black, unmarked speedboat coming your way. It'll reach the shore pretty quickly here. It has no markings of any kind for any agency, but knowing what you know, it's probably related to those people that Yasha said had vanished away, the BG family. And yes, the Aurora Borealis only happens really, yeah, in those areas. This is not, like, geographically the right location for that.
I guess we'll go take a peek at who's on that boat.
The people on the boat are just men and women with black shirts, black pants, short sleeves, gloves, black baseball caps, no markings, sunglasses. They are seated at various locations around the boat. It looks like there's enough room for you and Blue. In fact, there are two seats opposite one another. They just kind of wait. One of them approaches you, Icebeak, and says, Ma'am, your boat?
Are you ugly, Chief?
I was sent by a person to pick you up.
I see, and have you been informed of our other passengers?
He looks at all the people that are surrounded, that you know, there at the little village. We didn't bring enough boats for this many people. We could. He starts to take out a new Zeke.
No, the president and his mistress. Or, sorry, the president's son and his mistress.
Oh, right. He closes his phone and then looks up at Have a Hedge. She is at least a few inches taller than him. He gives her a small, like, kind of nod. All right, ma'am. We've been informed that we should be taking you to see the president personally. Do you have any objection to that? Do you need any sort of preparation, bottled water, bathroom break? Have a Hedge looks kind of a little insulted as she folds her arms. I am not a little kid. I can go. Yeah, sure. You're going to take me to president? You going to take me to see my sweetheart? She kind of looks a little coy. The man in the uniform kind of looks a little uncomfortable. Yes, to your sweetheart. Yeah, we've been given orders, of course, to facilitate your safe transport to your desired location, which I have been informed is, in fact, into the... Well, I won't say custody of Post-Valentine, but... He kind of like lowers his baseball cap for a moment. The loving arms of your sweet honey bee, I think is what I have heard. He kind of like, you can already see him gritting his teeth and then like mouthing the words back to himself. Have a Hedge kind of like clasps her hands together and then tilts her head. Oh, that sounds fine. Well, she turns towards Icepeak and Blue. If you are coming along, maybe we could have small chat about things. You know, she kind of like indicates towards you, Icepeak. You're pretty tall and slender. Have you considered a career in dance?
I do enjoy the musical arts, but I have found that my movements are not considered humanly natural.
Yes, of course. Plus, I guess at your age, it's a little silly. To start, you know, you probably would have wanted to do it like 10 years ago-ish, maybe a little younger.
I do not, my body does not age nor use gravity in the same way as yours, so I think it would not be difficult. If I were to split my body in half, I could be 5 years old, at least the size of one.
Have a Hedge, like, looks you over. I speak very closely. Are you saying you've had work done?
I am saying that I am of the sea. A child of the sea.
Okay, sure thing. Well, if you change mind, I am actually in pretty good with a lot of the dance companies in the Red Kingdom and abroad. I have danced for... kings and former kings and dictators and momentary rulers. One guy I did a dance for on performance, he was assassinated pretty much the day after. So technically, my performance was the best he had ever seen in his life, which means a lot to me. I think it's very important.
I take her hand, I put another hand over her, over that hand, and I say, I am sure you dance beautifully.
A performance to remember. A performance to die for. She kind of, like, giggles a little behind her hand. It feels good to just relax a little. I hated that stuffy golden love. You know, Posty said that I had to stay there with Tommy Lee until there were some troubles that he had to take care of. Something about some fishy guy corporation or something. And then I saw on the news he did another execution, which I have told him maybe don't do because it's not so good, but he loves it and the ratings and everything. She starts to step on the boat as she's talking.
I guide her in and make sure her child is also there.
Tommy Lee, who is this, like, kind of very, he's, like, kind of a flat, expressionless, faced kid, follows along. He takes Hava Hedge's hand. He's almost more like an accessory than a person at times. He doesn't really say much or move much unless she moves.
Good evening, Tommy Lee. Are you also a dancer?
He just kind of stares up at you quietly. With you, give me a gaze roll, I guess. Something's real weird about this kid. You can't exactly pin down what, but he's a very strange boy. Oh. With a five, you can make the assessment that he is not. He's not. He doesn't mean to be silent to as an insult. He just maybe has trouble talking, and also there is something off about him. You can't tell if he has some kind of like disability or maybe he's just terminally shy. But he is. He does have like a deer in the headlights pose almost when you are talking to him and looking at him in the eyes.
I look away and ask if you would prefer a book or some other form of entertainment. I could find some avail to you.
He kind of like pulls on Hava Hedge's hand and then runs and hides behind her.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, no, it's okay. He is a special boy. She kind of brings Tommy Lee back around in front of her and puts her hands on his shoulders. He has always had some trouble dealing with people, but he loves cowboys. And guns.
I have also have trouble communicating, but I do know a cowboy.
Do you? Tell me more. Oh, you know what? Tell Tommy Lee more. She kind of like sits down on the in the boat and puts Tommy Lee on her lap. You notice that when she's sitting down with Tommy Lee on her lap, it looks almost like he's a ventriloquist dummy.
Oh, no!
Like, he's just sitting there in his little suit with his, like, simple, plain little face, staring. Tommy Lee, the nice lady wants to tell you about the cowboy she knows.
He has a very long gun and likes to drink near campfire.
Tommy Lee, every time you mention a detail, he raises and lowers his fists together. Like he's like cheering on the information that you're giving him.
Oh no. I'll just kind of talk a little bit about how nice Clint is, I guess.
Regale him with stories of Clint. Tommy Lee seems fascinated by the just the idea of Clint, the fact that there is a cowboy. Blue, you give me a gaze roll. You have somewhat of a piercing gaze. You can sort of like perceive things through details like clothing, walls, that sort of thing. You are picking up on something in Tommy Lee's sleeves and on his knees, like sort of on the legs. He's got some kind of like brace. He's got a body brace. It's kind of streamlined, hidden under his clothes. But it's almost like when a kid has like, you know, the rickets or polio or just like a disability to keep them their bones straight. He's got some kind of apparatus on. There's even little small clicks every time he, like, raises and lowers his fist.
She'll kind of nod to them and ask, hey, did he have an accident, or is he sick?
Owlhead seems surprised that you noticed. Oh, did you see something? She kind of like readjusts Tommy Lee in her lap.
He was born a little bit different from most children. At first, they weren't sure that he was going to make it. The process was quite grueling. It took 12 hours of surgery. Reconstruction as well. Yes, Tommy Lee here is special.
She kind of strokes his head as she talks about him.
I think part of why my honey post fell in love was because of Tommy Lee. Before that, he and I were just passionate number, I guess. He loved to see me dance, and who can blame him? But after the boy, I was worried, scared that he would just cast us aside. I mean, Tommy Lee is different. He has considerations for future. He is learning is different, his body is different, and he will probably need care for most of life. I thought post-Valentine, he does not tolerate weakness. He does not tolerate these things, defects. He won't tolerate this. He'll forget that who we are, he'll forget to visit, he'll forget to call, birthdays, but something about when he saw this boy. He loved this boy.
She kind of gives Tommy Lee a small jump with her leg.
I think he loves this boy more than he loved me. Sometimes I think that he sees in Tommy Lee something he was missing with his own father. It is very sweet, I think. Very, very sweet.
Everyone sees post-Valentine as monster.
Yeah, not true. He is not. Hard, yes, in the old tradition. But his heart bleeds like all others. And for Tommy Lee,
she gives him another hop.
Both Valentine would bleed every drop he has.
It's unexpectedly sweet.
Well, that is the thing about human. We are all monsters and sweet children at the same time. All of us have our own problems and parts, segments of life. Innocent, some not so much. But at the heart of every man and woman, a small, small, sweet child. Just like my Tommy Lee.
She gives him a hug.
It is only when they grow up that they hide it behind layers of adulthood and purpose, meaning, mission, needing success, money, women, drugs. I suppose you and your sister here are like new to world in way. You have been raised with human, correct? I am to assume? I hope I am not being too forward with asking.
I was born in Twilight Depths, so there was a time before being raised by humans, but yes.
Ah, what wicked things must be down in those depths. And yet, here you are.
Yes, well, I am wicked thing. I just got very lucky to
you become are
wicked? Baby.
I do not think you are wicked. Someone who was wicked would probably have hurt me or Tommy Lee or held us hostage for something, money, political power, whatever. But your first instinct, both of you, was to make sure that we are okay. That is not monstrous. That is very, very nice. You are like true heroes, I think. You even make Tommy Lee smile. He smiles for no one. but he's Papa.
Tommy Lee has the very smallest smile on his face. It barely looks like his face is changed at all, but there is the small curl of a smile. As your boat is now preparing to depart, the people on the island, Stalls, Tina, and Crosby, join Yasha to see you off. And you can see that Crosby has his head bowed and is kind of saying small prayers under his breath into your direction as he kind of gently pushes his hands out in the air towards your boat.
Make sure this boat gets to nice, clean waters for purpose and for flow. May you have a blessed journey. Saviors of Doma, daughters of our blood.
Stalls looks a little uncomfortable with all the prayer talk, and Tina is like kind of humoring Crosby, but she also will wave to your boat as it's preparing to depart. Come back sometime. Things will look nicer. I have plans.
Big remodel.
Yasha kind of looks a little concerned.
Remodel? How expensive is remodel exactly? We're not made of money like you, Tina.
Tina just kind of harumphs about it. But they're all waving you off as your boat begins to depart. Stalls eventually breaks his stoic stance.
Come back sometime. Anytime you feel like now, if you want to. It wouldn't be weird.
You may all visit me in Guam. When the tides pull you there.
Your boat, maybe. He kind of like starts to point at it. I think I see hole. You should probably come back, right? Nah, they are not going to fall for this.
You promised to come visit my apartment and stay there for, I believe, there was no date.
I'll be there. Just make sure bed, couch, comfortable. All Stalls wants. Comfortable bed, couch. Futon? Futon.
I will buy futon as I sleep in tech.
I will put futon.
Blue is smiling and she's misty-eyed and she says, we will see you again. Count on it.
All right, yeah, go ahead.
I turned across me and I say, thank you for your advice. I will try to learn the flow better.
Crosby bows his head.
Whatever happens out there, know that the waters of Doma will be with you, in your veins, and at your feet when you need it most. Doma does not forget. The flow will not forget. For it ever turns and ebbs throughout this entire world. Through the rain, through the tides, the floods, even in the snow. Doma will be there. Do not think that you are alone.
I will always be grateful for Doma.
He bows his head and then takes a step back away from the boat as it departs from the shore with Tommy Lee and Hava Hedge aboard. The people on the island have all gathered at the shore, the old men, the children. They are waving their hands as you depart. Some of them are jumping up and down, trying to get you to see them a little, at least that they're waving. These people, you can tell, probably didn't want you to leave, but you have a mission, and the world is bigger than this island. Speaking of missions, you, Mikey, were with a group of ninja after your mission, and you managed to get your contact, who I will drag out here, Lazaro, to medical care, in a small facility unmarked in the basement of a magazine shop. There is actually a surprising amount of medical equipment there that they've hooked Lazaro into. He is currently being treated for a number of wounds, but it looks like he will be stable enough to survive for another day. He is now non-responsive because he's asleep. But I'm assuming you would at least go to check in on him if you were allowed to do so.
Yeah.
Lazaro's, now that you see him lying here like this, there is something about him that is maybe you don't notice because he's always animated, moving around, making jokes, little strange comments, or overall being somewhat, we'll say whimsical. But now that he's just lying here in a bed hooked up to all this equipment, you could swear he just looks like an old man. He's young in appearance. He is sprightly and lively when he is up and about, but lying here still, he looks like almost like a fossil. Something about how still he is, how strange and ageless he is in this state. Not quite a vampire, but almost like an embalmed body. Lazaro Limoncello, now lifeless, looks, well, dead. I mean, he isn't, but he looks like it.
Yeah, I guess I would have checked to, like, talk to the doctors to see how he's doing. Yeah, and then just looking upon this surprisingly old man now.
One of the doctors who's like here, there's like a staff of like three people. It's a very small medical facility. Obviously it's like a little hideaway. It's a little safe house. He's of course in a black doctor's uniform, but he looks like a normal guy. Otherwise he kind of, folds his arms and he has a mask on his face. So you can't exactly see what he looks like, but you can tell he has like two, now that you actually get a look at him, he has two very beady eyes behind the mask. He kind of narrows his eyes. Your friend is very weird. You know that, don't you? You know how weird this guy is? Physiologically speaking, he's very strange.
I mean, I'm a mer person, so strange is my day-to-day.
Oh no, I've done hundreds of autopsies on mer people. You're normal, really. Much more normal than this. I could probably do an autopsy on you right now and find less anatomical strangeness in your body than in this one right here.
I mean, what's so strange about him? He's a human. One heart, two lungs, stomach, maybe a gallbladder.
Well, for one, he seems to be, I don't know, locked without being able to age, but he's not a vampire per se. He's more like a wax dummy. I don't think you really understand the weirdness of this one, but you can take my word for it.
I guess I kind of have to. I mean, my own medical examiner, she's not here right now to confirm this, but I'll pass everything along.
Oh, you're talking about Dr. Icepeak?
Yeah, yes. Yeah, I forgot you probably know who we are.
I do. But I shouldn't tell you that, or why. So, don't ask questions. like, you can ask questions after this one, but not about that thing.
Okay.
Don't be weird.
Don't
make it weird.
I mean, you don't have to keep bringing it up. That makes it weird too.
I feel weird now. Can you help me to feel normal about this?
Okay, Doc. If he's a wax dummy of a person, I mean, I guess did you put him back together well enough?
Oh no, the organs all operate normally, of course, and he's a human being with supple skin. Wax dummy was more of a euphemism or an analogy or comparison, a simile, if you will, or one of those. But either way, no, he functions like a human being. It's just that I feel like if we were to give him an organ transplant, his body would reject it no matter what blood type it is, or if there was any kind of, well, you know, donor list for guys that he kind of like pokes Limoncello's foot like this. If I didn't know any better, I'd say you just dug him up recently.
I mean, yeah, I mean, he's spry for his age. That's all it is.
It wouldn't be weird, though, if you dug him up.
Why would I dig him up? He's a
Well, maybe you just get curious every now and
then. I'm sorry, how many living people get buried that...
I have work to do. Do you have any other questions?
I have so many, but you said I can't ask like half of them.
And that stands. Thank you, Detective De La Cruz, for bringing us this interesting specimen. It's going right into my files. He'll live.
Thank you, Doctor. And he kind of like pauses to wait for an answer. I didn't get your name.
No. You didn't. Maybe later we'll be able to introduce each other, like one another, like right. I could have you over. I don't think my mother would mind having another person over here.
Oh, and okay, and your mom is?
Gladys. I can't tell you that. You know what? It doesn't matter. Her name is Mother, and if I call her anything else, it's gonna be an earful, okay?
Okay. Okay, thank you. I guess.
There's no need to guess.
Personal. Okay.
You either thank me or you don't.
No, I mean, I am, but.
Don't make this weird.
I'm not making it weird.
I'm feeling weird.
Okay. Well, I'm going to stay here with him. I don't know if you need to go somewhere.
Oh, no, you're not. He kind of closes the curtains around Lazaro. I have orders to send you off.
Oh, well, they didn't send me any orders. Okay.
Yeah, you're not an agent.
Meeting up with the others.
He hands you like a thick envelope of papers. There, read that.
Oh, okay. Yeah, Mikey will do like the cartoon kind of like just taking the pages and thumbing them and just holding it by like, you know, the spine. And he goes, okay, so do I just need to sign all this now or?
It's actually a novel. That you're reading,
oh,
not very well.
It's an actual book. It's not
an actual book.
Law, like, you know, legal stuff.
It's a book. He just says, what do you think about the second act?
I mean, I thought it was okay.
Really? Just okay. Give me that. He snatches the papers back. I'll see you later, detective.
It just seems a little confusing to switch between the first and third person. Hey.
Criticism really stings. He just kind of like puts his hand over his face.
If they're different characters, it would make sense. he just left. I guess he's left standing there because the doctor told them to leave, but the doctor left first.
Yeah, the doctor left. There are some incoming text messages to your phone regarding meeting up with a few of the others. Outside of a location sort of close to one of the local political squares of Vladivostok. You have that information like in your phone, but making calls out away from your phone is kind of like a little bit difficult. There is a location that you are supposed to meet them or meet up with people at called the Central Square Memorial, located in Vladivostok. It was once a memorial to the war dead, now has been retrofitted into memorializing victims of environmental accidents. Central Square Memorial is actually a real place in Vladivostok. I didn't make it up.
Oh, fun.
Okay, yeah, then I guess I'll head there so I can see how it went with everybody else.
Okay.
Yeah, or at least hope that everyone's there.
As you are on your way there, the first thing you'll notice on the outside, now that you are, like, outside, is the blue ribbons in the sky. Obviously, people in the crowd around different locations, different buildings, they're all kind of, like, staring up, transfixed at this. What is... You are a man of the world. You don't even need to roll for it. That's the Aurora Borealis.
I feel like Mikey would just look up and see it and just go,
At this latitude, at this time of year, that's not right. And then he'll probably
like look around at the sky then, and then just kind of, that's probably not good.
All right, so that's where Mikey is heading. For you, Enya, you and your partner, Father John, made work of that man Nordwind. And then had to drive back to the city with Father John behind the wheel. He actually lifts up his sunglasses. Is that the goddamn Aurora Borealis?
I'm seeing it too. What? I don't know what that's possibly about. That doesn't have anything to do with what we just did.
He lowers the sunglasses. Yep, not my business. You're absolutely right. I'm sure whatever's happening will sort itself out just fucking fine. He leans backwards and you hear a beer crack open. I probably shouldn't drink this while I'm driving. He hands it to you. There you go.
I don't... Whatever. She's gonna throw it back. Look, the sooner we get back with... someone will know what's going on, I'm sure.
Maybe. But I wouldn't put money on it, to be honest with you.
Well, couldn't we pray to something?
You can pray to God if you want, sure. But he's likely the one that's putting that up in the sky to begin with. I mean, or he's allowing it, don't you think? I mean, unless that's some sort of new Red Kingdom weapon of some kind, like a super weapon that could, like, melt everybody's brains or something. I mean, it could be that. I don't really know much about, like, military history and technology, if I'm being perfectly honest. It's not my forte. I'm mostly into the Bible stuff, you know, theology, a little bit of biblical history, of course. I took some night courses, actually, for the sciences, but I was a Midland science student, more of a humanity, arts and humanities guy, like.
Yeah, you know, I think I'm more willing to believe that it's some sort of super weapon than some sort of supernatural thing. That concerns me.
Well, heck, why not both?
Aw, man, she's gonna take another swig.
Yeah. Enya, you also have a call in your Uzik to meet up at the Central Square Memorial. Though, just like the others, your bars on your Uzik are very low.
Alright, they have a destination.
Once I drop you off back in the city, you're probably not going to see me again, just so you know. So if there's anything you'd like to say to me, like, you know.
You're still alive, so there's still plenty to do, right?
I was just hoping there'd be, like, maybe something meaningful, like we had a moment or something.
Hey, are you going to go back to working for the Antichrist?
Yeah, likely so.
Well, you have your reasons.
Sure I do. I'm sure it'll all pan out, whatever happens. Yep. God works in mysterious ways, doesn't he?
Whoever God is. Yeah, I think so.
Well, if you'd like to know more, I have a whole book about him.
You know what? We have time. Go ahead.
Oh, that's wonderful. He presses play on his car's speaker system, and it just starts up. My name is Father John, and I will be reading from the entirety of the Bible. Chapter 1, Genesis.
Do you really just read this whole thing with that tone?
He presses pause. Yes?
I can't tell if it's professional to do it that way, or if you could have added a little more intonation for, you know, interest. But sorry, it's small critique. I'm sure the content speaks for itself.
Right, well, maybe just listen to a little of it and tell me what you think. And he starts it again. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth, it just goes on like that. He has, in fact, recorded himself reading the entirety of the Bible, indeed starting with the book of Genesis.
Oh, she's going to have him pausing frequently as she asks questions. Because this is something she's never looked into.
Oh no, I speak has fallen over.
No, it didn't.
She's magnetically aligned, so.
You have to hold control while you use the mouse wheel.
Oh, it didn't used to be the cocaine. Sorry, I didn't mean to stop things.
In time, you will be on your way towards the Central Square Memorial, Enya, and you will also listen to the good book with Father John. And then finally, Claudia, after your great date with destiny and the eventual acquisition of one Kanopka Presser, who was taken in by those unmarked agents, you presume likely to be Rivers, Helena looks like she's had something of a blast out on the field. I mean, the racetrack, the 55 drive racetrack is in ruins. Smoke, fire, chaos. Helena just soaks it in like she's catching a tan. That was wild. I want to do it again.
Please don't.
Okay, whatever. Oh no, I speak as engaged the narrator tools that I turned back on.
No, it's a thing.
Hello.
Yeah. It was a thing during the first campaign. I just never used it much.
The way I'm engaging.
Do you need to figure out how to get off of that?
It doesn't sound like it.
Yeah, it sounds like you're suffering.
I did it in the first place. I'm really sorry.
There you go. I mean, that's a fun thing I might mess around with at some point. I just wasn't going to do it this session because of all the stuff I've already got to like balance, but I'm glad you found the button.
I didn't mean to. I'm really sorry. Can't go. I didn't. Please go on.
Okay. Helena, once you ask her not to, she just kind of like poo-poos you.
That's fair.
Whatever. Like, I get it. You have like a job and like stuff to do and like a family or something. So you probably aren't that interested in the whole destruction derby bit like I am. But if you ever change your mind, you know, could always use more bodies out there and more cars for more wrecks.
What?
You know what I'm saying. She kind of winks. Like, you could get into a car and crash it. Plus, you're not even, like, full human. You're something else. So you could probably survive something like that. That's got to be a crowd pleaser, I bet. Just fly right through the windshield, hit the wall like a flaming crash test dummy. Get up, dust yourself off. Perfectly fine.
I mean, while you're not wrong, I'm not about to do that?
Yet. Not about to do that yet.
Why do you say yet, huh? Are you implying I'm about to get into a wreck?
She kind of motions towards the wreckage of the racetrack that she's left behind. I mean, I don't know if you know the statistics on getting into a car crash, but they're pretty high, especially when there's someone like me on the road. Just saying, I'm the single largest bump in the auto insurance industry in the past year, and I'm proud of that.
I don't know if I would say past year. I would say past decade, probably.
Ooh, how old flatterer. Are you? She kind of like, how old am I? Old enough to buy beer, Grandma.
Whatever it is, that's definitely increased the mortality rates exponentially, I'm sure.
You know what they say? Kill them all and let God sort them out.
I'm not sure I agree with that at all, but you do you.
Don't worry. I always do. You probably have, like, stuff you need to go do now, right? I mean, I doubt you want to hang out and take another lap around this track. I don't think anyone is going to, as a matter of fact.
I would if I wanted more injuries, but I don't.
Claudia, you also have received that text message about meeting up at the Central Square Memorial.
Ah. And a new job has presented it to me, so I think this is where we part ways.
Yeah, it's just a shame. I thought I'd end up having to kill you. But it turns out I didn't have to after all. So I guess I'll never really find out if I could have done it. She kind of just really sits there in contemplation. Maybe next time. And then she smiles.
Yeah, next time maybe you should think a little bit more before you think about that. I don't go down easy.
She kind of covers her mouth and looks away. Yeah, I'm not even going to play off that one. I've got to go check on my car. You take care, detective, if that is your real name. I'm just fucking with you. I know it's not.
If my name was detective, I would be ashamed.
Elena is seemingly in her environment. Here amongst the chaos, the wreckage, the people screaming. She looks like she's just a natural part of it. Leaving her here, probably, I don't think it's going to get much worse than it already is. There's still fighting going on in the stands. And probably a good idea for you to make your exit for that reason. Also, agents of River seem to be like doing whatever they can to stop some of the chaos and carnage. But, yeah, they're doing what they can. They seem to just be normal people in nondescript clothes. For you, they actually have a car waiting because Helena will be staying here. So you have your own vehicle, your own transportation back to Vladivostok proper since you're outside of the city limit.
All right. She'll probably take it and get going as soon as possible.
All right. That will put you on your way to Vladivostok. And then finally, sitting amidst several body bags and a full buffet table, Towner and Alsatia are just kind of quietly both sitting there, each holding a large sandwich. Pieces of the sandwich are disappearing in Alsatia's hands, and Towner's just taking bites out of it. And he just looks at her and says,
"Oh, you want anything later? Cause, I'm gonna be hungry. Like, I'm not asking you on a date or anything, but, like, you know, you do the food thing, I do the eating food thing.
I mean, it's just a, like, it's more like a, this is, could be a friendship, I think. I think we could be friends. And you don't talk much either, which, you know. He takes another bite of his sandwich. Like, which is good, because, like, you know, people talk too much, and it makes me want to, like, punch him out. And, like, sometimes I just don't know what's going on, because, like, I'm distracted or whatever. So, like, it's like a plus. I mean, it's, you're pretty weird. Like, you're going to have to stop murdering people all the time. It's a hard lesson. But you're going to have to learn it someday. I know I had to. You know, you can't just murder people. Oh, hold on. He checks his phone. Ah, shit, I gotta go. He starts to scoop a couple more food items off of the buffet table and, like, gather them up into his arm. All right. So, I guess I'll catch you later. I didn't really get to learn much about you, and you're still, I mean, like, I said friendship, but, like, honestly, you're still kind of, like, you're a little bit scary. Yeah, you're a little scary, but I'm a shark, so, you know, I get it. You know, looks aren't everything. Can't judge a book by its cover, or a lady by the cover that she is wearing over her body, like a, yeah, I'm gonna go. Alsatia just watches him leave, doesn't say anything. Thus was the interaction between them, as he is also on his way. And so we have the gathering eventually of Aqua outside of the Central Park, or the Central Square Memorial. As all of you gather up in this area, eventually meeting at an agreed-upon location as directed by your Uzeek messages, the first thing that you'll notice is it seems like there is a large gathering, and the second thing you'll notice is there's a large amount of Seven Nation Army security around, but they seem a little bit distracted by the, well, quote-unquote celebrations.
Who finds who first?
Well, I mean, Towner is a giant shark, man, so he sticks out, and Mikey is like 7 feet tall.
But we're supposed to be hiding as other people in Russia, right?
Towner wouldn't stand out as just like a shark, man, but you can't miss him anyway. You know what it's like.
Yeah, he's built, he's built like the Rock.
Is that the local borscht stand or whatever? What's the street food?
I was gonna say, yeah, it's me and him eating street food, and you can tell because of, like, you know, giant string bean man, and then, like, giant wide guy, and, like, I'm just eating sauerkraut, and he's just eating this, like, the sausage that came with the sauerkraut. It's a perfect setup. We're both happy.
One for you, one for me. One for you, one for me.
You both were attracted to the same food cart at the exact same time, and that's how you found each other.
Yes.
Yeah, just a coincidence. Mikey, in the time you've been sitting here with Towner at the stand, he's just been regaling you with stories. Yeah, she could turn anything into food. Anything. She could turn food into food.
Wait, are you saying she could turn it back into... Wait, could she change what the dish was functionally?
Yeah.
Oh, see, that's actually kind of cool.
She turns spaghetti, he leans in closer, into fettuccine.
Oh, that's weird. Wait, why did you need to do that? Or was that after?
It's just like I wanted to eat fettuccine and then there was spaghetti. And I said, I would like some fettuccine. And she turned it into fettuccine.
Oh, she's cooking for you. So what you're saying is she's cooking for you. Did you get her number?
No, she doesn't use a phone. She doesn't actually talk.
Oh, I mean, I guess you could text.
She just kind of hisses. And cries. And bleeds.
Oh.
Yeah, it's pretty scary.
Sounds right up your alley.
No, you'd think. You know, blood in the water, that kind of thing. No. No, it just freaks me out. Ever mention I'm scared of ghosts?
No, not really. That would explain, you know, the House of the Rising Sun and stuff.
Yeah! Don't tell anybody.
And he just kind of, like, looks around. And he's like, who am I gonna tell? None of these.
I don't know, you see a ghost, like, don't tell him.
Well, I'm not gonna. Why would I tell the ghost, especially?
I don't know. I just gotta cover my bases on this one. You understand?
No, you. I would never.
Yeah, I know. For now. He just kind of gives you suspicious.
He just kind of like gives him a what? Like what? Like a shoulder shrug? Like, what do you mean for now? Like, but he doesn't. But he just keeps eating because he's probably used to this, like, towner, like, saying or doing something and be like, don't say anything.
Yeah. Don't embarrass me. I'm a large shark.
I'm a large shark man with feelings. Let me have him.
Yeah. Large shark man with tiny little shark eyes.
Yeah, they get somehow beadier.
So yeah, the rest of you would obviously, these two stand out.
Yeah. And he's going to gravitate towards that food cart as well, just because she's got alcohol and there wasn't anything to eat back there.
Yeah, but we're fish people. It's fine. Just get day drunk. We're not technically working anymore. We did it.
All true. Hey, you two. Glad to see you're both alive. Any idea on what that's all about? And she's gonna
No, actually. It's not the right time of year for this, and I don't think we're high enough north. How'd it go? I don't see Father John with you.
I don't see either of you with your, you know.
Oh, he's in the hospital.
Oh.
So, I mean, he's fine. They say he'll pull through. The doctor was really awkward, though.
Huh. Well, was he a nice guy?
The doctor? Yeah, I mean, he was just really awkward. He was trying to be very smoke and mirrors, but he was explaining why he had to be very secretive, so it was giving it away. And then he was trying to make up for it, and it was just a whole thing.
No, I mean your partner.
Oh, yeah, no, like I said, he's fine. We did it. He just got, you know, he's got burned up. You know, they can't all go great.
Ugh. Well, I'm glad you're fine.
Yeah, you can see Mikey's a little not fine, and he just goes, yeah.
You too.
She's gonna give him a slap on the shoulder.
With you guys all gathered, it seems like there is some kind of event starting. Announcements are going off, and music is starting to play over a speaker system that is, a series of them that are located all throughout the memorial square. You will notice that on a center stage in the memorial, post Valentine steps out onto the stage, surrounded by a crowd of Seven Nation Army officers. He has something in a bag, and he grabs a microphone for this crowd of thousands, assuming you are at the back of the crowd.
This thing on? Oh, it's on. Good. I would like to make one last reminder. Of course, he takes the bag off of the head of Sonny Fortuna.
Whose mouth is agape and eyes are pretty much dead, foggy and cloudy. Tongue hanging out of mouth. He holds up the head.
We did it, everybody. We killed that son of a bitch. You know, a lot of people out there, he kind of like shakes the head at the crowd. A lot of people out there say, this guy here was the Antichrist. That makes me like a holy hero because I killed the Antichrist. I murdered the shit out of the Antichrist. Look at him. He shakes the head again, causing the tongue to waggle. There's never been a more dead Antichrist than this one right here. I'm going to have this put on my wall. Maybe I'll even put it on a chain hanging around my neck. Today is a new day, everybody. An absolute grand miracle of a day. Because not only did I kill the Antichrist. Come out here, honey.
Pavel Hedge walks out onto the stage, waving to the crowd.
I'm pleased to announce that I am finally going to marry my longtime love and father of my child. Pavel Hedge Pantacrita. She has changed my life in so many ways.
He puts the head back into a bag and just hands it off to another officer.
Of course, this wouldn't be a proper Seven Nation Army celebration if I didn't have a bit of a death and a wedding. Which is why I'm going to be wed to this beautiful, beautiful woman. Live.
He holds his fingers to his ears. And then makes a cutting motion across his neck. And then puts the microphone closer to his mouth.
What do you mean the towers are down? We have a transmission that we need to put out to the world. Now, I don't give a fuck about interference. If one of you guys doesn't fix this, all of you are going to be spending a long time in one of these deep, dark cells somewhere and a place I'm going to fucking forget. So you better fix the system.
He looks back at the crowd.
You see this? Just idiots everywhere. Everyone messing up at every single step. Technical difficulties. Seriously. I'm sorry, honey, baby.
Kisses Hava Hedge's hand.
It's really embarrassing, actually. It's really fucking embarrassing. In front of the woman I love.
Hava Hedge just kind of like shies away a little and then kind of gives a, you know, like a conciliatory like nod and just pats him on the back. There, don't worry about it, honey. It's fine, really. I didn't even know that we were going to do this right now, actually. Tommy Lee doesn't even... I have to get him a new suit.
Post, like, pauses and then picks up Tommy Lee.
What do you say, little man? Do you want to call me dad from now on? For real? Not just, like, over the phone, but, like, in front of people and everything. You want to really be a Valentine? Tommy Valentine has such a nice, nice name. Tommy Lee Valentine.
He just kind of like, you know, bounces Tommy Lee up and down. And Tommy Lee has kind of the same expression that he always does. Maybe slight smile. Hava Hedge kind of takes a step back and puts her hands down in front of her lap. Just kind of smiling. She seems a little nervous in front of the crowd. They seem, for the most part, the audience, let's see what the audience reaction is. Score of 1 to 100. Sort of on the way to being, like, sort of hype, but they seem like they're a little bit, like, put off by the bloody head that he was dangling around. You guys all have like a moment if you want to like talk or interact amongst yourself. But according to the mission parameters given to you by Leroy, something was supposed to happen. And it probably wasn't that he was going to get his head cut off when he pretended to be Sonny Fortuna.
Hey, did anyone else know about Secret? Mistress and kid?
No. That wasn't in any of the stuff.
Did that mess up ever anything?
I mean, Sonny's dead, so it probably messed up a lot of things.
He was found on the island where Blue and I were. When the head came out, I speak probably did kind of like lean a little too close. on Blue, like almost hold her hand or arm.
Oh yeah, I guess we also found out they're siblings. Something we didn't know up until just now.
Yeah,
you have it, but Iceek is now hugging onto Blue, so.
Yes, Blue will put her arm around Ice Peak and hold her up.
Have a rough time, you guys.
It's, well, they're...
And he's also going to hug them. Yeah, I can use one too.
Ice Peak is very surprised, but does not object.
Group hug.
I just, the head was disturbing. I may need a moment. Do you think we will be able to retrieve the body?
That's not, they couldn't really, right?
I mean, there's got to be something else, right? Like, he wanted us to take out all those people at a very specific time. It doesn't make sense that he would, like, knowingly be executed without a backup plan.
I did send him the, well, I believe it was the All-Star. The Hand of that... Don Reyes?
Say what again? You sent him the Hand of somebody?
Yeah, what happened on your mission, you guys?
We were split up for a time, but we... I'm not sure if this is the place, but we were successful in our mission. I do not see Nicholas. Where would he have delivered the hand if not to... She just kind of, like, stares at the... wherever the head is.
Yeah, the head is just kind of there. It's in the possession of one of the officers standing off to the side. They're just holding it up, kind of showing it for cameras and pointing at it and taking pictures of it, like, smashed against their own face while they make a similar dead guy expression.
Please let us retrieve it.
Retrieve the head? Or the hand?
The head.
Why do you want the head so bad?
Why could you not wish to bury a comrade?
What?
He deserves a burial. Proper burial.
Avo Hedge on the stage, like, now she's watching, Post-Valentine and Tommy Lee play. She kind of, like, takes out a cigarette and lights it. And stares at him for a moment. And then she picks up a microphone. Hello, everybody. I am Avo Hedge Pantakura. You may know me or remember me from doing ballet dances throughout the world. I am soon to be Avo Hedge Valentine. Pentacritor, I may keep. Maybe it's little Pentacritor Valentine is a big mouthful. The crowd kind of, well, let's see how they react. Oh, they like the joke. It's sensible. She gets a sensible chuckle from the audience. She kind of, like, nods her head at them, almost graciously. There are big changes coming to Seven Nations and to Red Kingdom, for certain. Because I am citizen of Red Kingdom, and I am trying not to have everything be biased about what we can do for us. But changes to structure, to social aid, to radiation treatment, sickness, environmental concern, that sort of thing. Most importantly, it is good now for us to look forward as not only a new couple that is going to bring a new dawn to all of the Seven Nations, but also as the bringers of a new age of peace. She kind of steps forward a little and flicks the cigarette. Peace is important.
one would argue peace is the most important thing that there is in this world. When I met this man, my lovely post, he was a man consumed with war. I gave him all sorts of good advice, I think, on how to reduce war. And he followed some, but it is also, I know it's his place as man in relationship to just do as he wishes. I am just pretty face, honestly, just ballerina. She kind of like blushes a little and hides her face. Still, I think I have sort of good idea. For example, to teach about the importance of child care and medicine, I made some changes, I think, in how I raised my son. After he was born, Tommy Lee opens his mouth and you hear a clicking mechanism. I replaced most of his biological matter with cybernetic parts that are military grade. A large gun barrel slides out of his mouth and presses against Post-Valentine's head. You see, Tommy Lee is probably 99% mechanical at this point. The biological parts actually were not disposed of, but instead have been repurposed in what I can only describe as some sort of alternate reality prison. The gun makes a loud click sound like a hammer being drawn down. Now, if you move even a little, El Presidente, your son will blow your head off. Now, she walks forward with the microphone. That includes all of your guards, every single one. If any of you move towards the stage or try to stop me, you will see this man's head painted all over this stage. It must seem cruel, I'm sure. After all, he and I have had a relationship for quite some time. Right, Post? You probably shouldn't nod. Tommy Lee has what I would refer to as a hair trigger. It's true. I haven't had much time to refine that particular design. But you may be wondering to yourself, Havelhedge, why have you done this? The thing about it is I don't really have to tell you. It would be fun to say something. But I think that it would be better if I just executed the plan, such as it is. She looks up. You hear an airplane flying overhead and can see the shadow of what looks like an old-timey fighter jet plane. And then a hand drops down right onto the ground in front of her. Yeah, there it is. She picks it up. It's got some tattoos on the back of the palm. This is Hand of Traitorous Samurai Don Reyes. Some of you may know him. One moment. She pulls a knife out of her dress, like just right next, like attached to her garter belt. And then holds up her arm and chops it right off. We're at the wrist, her right hand. It falls to the ground. Flops around, bleeding. The crowd right now is in hysterics. Obviously, they are in a great panic because the president is being held at gunpoint and this woman just chopped her own hand off. Let me tell you a little bit more about myself before I continue. You'll see, how about Hedge Pantacritor? Well, that's one name. She starts to adjust and put the Don Reyes hand over her missing hand and just kind of squeeze it into place. You can see steam rising from the wound. Who has the best vision here? Mikey, you have the best vision. Give me a gaze roll.
Oh, no.
Yeah, with this, you could see it.
There are what look like small spaceships or flight craft rotating around the wrist, hitting it with very, very tiny laser beams, basically fusing the flesh together. Once the hand is in place, there is a small pump action as her elbow flies forward and the wrist locks up, and then the hand begins to articulate as if she had always had it.
There we go. Just the same as if it were I was born with this thing. Who is Havel Hedge Pantagrader? To be honest, nobody at all. Because you see,
she just dispels this great grouping of black feathers and reveals herself as Leroy. Finally, I can stop doing that damned accent. Hello, everybody. My name is... well, you can just call me Leroy. And this is a hostile takeover of the entire Seven Nation Army. Brought to you by Dorobo. You see, I've been planning this all along with my various agents in the field and, of course, collaborators far and wide. I've been ensuring that all of the pieces are in place to have a successful coup. Starting with when I had one of my halves seduce and successfully become impregnated by this man. She kind of like nudges post-Valentine. You see, the work that we do is really such at a level that it really, genetics don't really cover it. The whole line. There's so much that we do. Dorobo is everything, isn't it? It's the clothes you have on your back. Did you know that most of those fibers were actually refined by Dorobo so that you have a smoother synthetic blend that does not itch you whenever you buy a new t-shirt without laundering it? That happened under our watch. And you are welcome for that. Post-Valentine seems like he's going to draw his sword, but then Tommy Lee further presses the gun barrel into his temple. Don't make a mess of things quite yet. I'll be honest with everyone here. The world is a mess, and I don't need to be a beautiful Russian ballerina to tell you that. Look at this place, really. In the time that I've been in the Red Kingdom, I've seen more human rights violations than I've seen smiling happy faces. I've seen more remnants and washed over forgotten war crimes than I have children playing in the street. I've seen a lot of bad things, folks. But mostly what I've seen is that the world is really looking for a new type of leader, a new type of government, you could even say. He looks around coyly and then back at the crowd. Some sort of new world order? Oh, get out of here. But it's true. Some sort of organization, perhaps one that is multinational, that could oversee a lot of the world's affairs without keeping it in an everlasting state of war, where the top 1% of the 1% are military bureaucrats and oligarchs that continue to loot the resources of people just like yourselves in the audience, and you military officers as well. If you think that the salary that you get is at all good compensation, you should talk to our recruitment people, because we can be very competitive about what we can give you in terms of salary. Very, very competitive. We actually do 5% above whatever your pay is. I mean, it's just flat out, that is a policy. So I'm saying, if this guy dies right here, who's going to miss him? Or the Valentines at all, for that matter? Really, honestly. One world war, and then another one shortly to follow after with the invasion of these Dagonites, which, as it turns out from the papers that were released by me, you're welcome, we find out that this man right here has been collaborating with the Dagonites to keep the world in a sort of war. In fact, before the Dagonites appeared, the whole economy was bound to collapse, but it was through the continued investment and the reinforcement, the consolidation of national powers and political forces in the face of a other inhuman terror. Well, because of all that, he was able to keep everybody from just doing what I'm about to do to him. Leroy sits down at the edge of the stage and adjusts the microphone cord and just kind of looks out at everybody. Can I just rap at you for a moment? Sure I can. Look, I'm going to be very specific about this. The world, as you know it, is about to change. For the better. There will be a peaceable kingdom while Leroy is in charge. Oh, but don't worry. I'll be taking my cues from all of the important social leaders and government officials that really did have your best interest in mind. I don't want to just take over and be another post-Valentine. Not my bag, really. I'm looking to create a utopia, I think. Something where we all have a purpose, a place, and most importantly, employment. Which is why, from now on, if anyone is unemployed, you will be considered an employee of Dorabo. Legally speaking, you will be working for us. Not only that, he looks around for a moment. All samurai not currently working for the Dorabo Corporation will be considered outlaws. So if you are currently operating as a private military contractor or any kind of government agent as part of a samurai clan, know this. If you aren't working for us, you're working against us. And that won't do. So from now on, if you have a samurai sword, I suggest you keep it sheathed, or better yet, maybe draw it for Dorabo's cause. That means doing good work for good people at good rates. And furthermore, he folds his legs and leans back a little. I'd like to take a moment to make sure that no matter what happens, or what I'm doing, or who I'm currently dealing with, Guam and Atlantis are considered off-limits. They are neutral territories. And through some strange loophole, which I could not have foreseen, surely, that means that samurai are maybe going to flee there. Like safe harbor. Who can say? Oh boy. Well, I did swear not, of course, to interfere with matters of Guam as part of the terms of this entire operation, and so if any of you samurai are out there and you don't want us to hunt you down, go to Guam. You're welcome. He leans back, kind of smug. Next order of business. I'd like to thank all of you out there for really believing in me. Could you just bring that head over to me for a second? He takes the head from the officer who very, very, very reluctantly brings over the head of Sunny. And he puts it down, like, onto his lap. Just looks at it. Looks a lot like me, doesn't it? Quick, fresh-made clone, 24 hours. You can't beat the turnover rate at this point. Speaking of, I would like to introduce you to what I would refer to as the Ouroboros Initiative. We'll call it that. From now on, if any of you, for any reason, have an unforeseen death, don't worry. We can bring you back. I guess what I'm announcing here is the end of death. For everyone who wants it. You will always be here as long as you wish to be. No more being beholden to things like fate or the supposed gods. I almost forgot. Worship of the gods of the moon will be forbidden from this day forward. Thank you. All right. I just had to make sure that I got that in there. Right. Where was I? Death has been abolished. War has had a collar put on it. Famine is a thing of the past with our great cloning technology. We will make sure that everyone has enough meat for the table. Steaks for every grill. Free of charge, I promise. No more disease.
No more fighting. No more nightmares. Just plain old good utopian value. Forever.
He throws the head up into the air and then catches it like a basketball. Hey, you, catch! And then he throws it out into the audience where there's screams. And he laughs. You can keep that.
I would like to catch it.
I'm going to try to catch the head of the clone head of Sunny Fortuna.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, go ahead and roll for it. Speed, if you will. Oh no. Well, with a one, you're going to miss. Do you want to spend a fate point? Okay, go ahead. You can re-roll it, you probably want to re-roll it.
Okay.
Oh shit!
Damn. What did you invoke to re? What did you invoke for that re-roll?
I guess I don't know what makes sense. I guess unorthodox eccentric doctor, but I want it. This is. For later experiments, I guess.
Oh, good. You now have in your possession one cloned head of Sunny Fortuna.
Mm-hmm.
Leroy.
Very deadly, though.
Leroy flexes his newfound hand. You know, I have a good feeling about this. There's a few things that I'm missing for the whole complete kit, but honestly, I'm really halfway there at this point. He pulls out a sword from, like, out of nowhere. It pretty much just, like, projects into reality next to his hand with a very strong striking sound, like thunder. This sword has a star-shaped cross guard, and the blade is looks like it's made out of pearl, almost. This is the All-Star. He points it towards the crowd. And you see them begin to move as if they're being pulled upwards and then dropped once the sword passes over them. It projects a magnetic field that you could probably compare to, oh, I don't know, really nothing that you'd find here on Earth. Originally, this was the sword of a very powerful person. And technically, by birthright and by heritage, if you could call it that, it is mine. It was stolen from me long ago. Well, from my heritage, of course. The All-Star has the capability to create strong magnetic fields indeed. And one thing that I'm learning very quickly is that there's a lot that relies on magnets in this modern day and age. Electrical equipment, for example, just really can't work well when there's a field of very strong electromagnetic interference. It just isn't going to happen. The signals get interrupted, circuits get fried, that sort of thing. But there are other circuits and synapses that maybe have some interference in them because of this. For example, one of the people in the audience just begins to stand up and you hear Leroy's voice being projected from him. You can completely manipulate a human being, every part of their brain, with magnets. Did you know that? Another person stands up and begins to talk with his voice. I knew that. I mean, technically speaking, medically speaking, I was aware. I just really wasn't sure that I could pull it off at this level. And then a third person gets up and starts talking. Well, by God, I'll tell you what. I could really talk from anyone's voice if I wanted, as long as you have a basic human brain. So, you know, you fish people. And I know you're out there. He kind of gives like a little point and wave to the crowd. I know you're out there. Doesn't quite work as well. I'm working on that part. But another thing that I found it can do, other than controlling the brain, is, well, changing perception. And then that's when you hear a click as Post Valentine is standing behind Leroy with Tommy Lee pointed at him.
Hold it right there, you son of a bitch.
Leroy kind of freezes. Uh-oh. And then Post Valentine pulls his face off. I thought you'd try something like this. You stupid bastard. Turns out I was double-crossing you the whole time, me. With my gun, Tommy Lee, of course. I've simply just been waiting in the wings, baiting you along the whole entire time. You shouldn't have trusted me one bit. Now you're going to pay the price. And then Ice Peak puts down the head of Sunny and steps up. Hold it right there. You stupid bastards. This has been a triple cross the whole time. How could you not see this coming, honestly? And really, she holds up the head of Sunny. Does this even look like me? What a shitty clone. And then, like, the rest of you that are there see Quattro breathlessly running towards your group. You've got to get out of here. You've got to go. Something really bad is happening. Something really strange, actually. I'm not sure what this is. Sorry, I just wasn't... He adjusts himself. Leroy stands in the midst of you. Huh. All right. Well, awkward. I think I should probably go join that thing over there. All of these Leroys begin to walk out of the audience and point weapons at each other and accuse each other of something. There are now at least 100 Leroys. No more than 200, but no less than 100 Leroys.
Enya's gonna... Can she make a grab for Ice Peak, Leroy?
Yeah, of course. Is this one over here?
Yeah, she's gonna grab that and just kind of...
Okay. No, Enya grabs her, and then Enya pulls out a gun and pulls off her mask. I got you now, you dumb bastard.
Oh, God. Everybody should just run.
I was gonna say, yeah, I think seeing that, Mikey would just go, okay, and just immediately start going the other direction. Just like right up into the air as fast as he can.
Mikey,
not
no matter,
touching anybody. Just
as you're flying, you see that the crowd is just turning into Leroy in waves. Like, almost like you're just a bird flying over the tides. You're watching Leroy wash over people. And then you're just slowly floating down to the ground. And you adjust your suit.
Because I saw Leroy. And
yeah,
I
you
had
saw
to,
Leroy.
And I had to double cross him.
But in fact, it was Leroy. Everybody you see. Blue, you see a few people, like a mother and her child, trying to run away, and then you watch as the child's face turns into Leroy's, and then the mother's face turns into Leroy, and then they look at each other and both draw guns and point at each other.
I was about to see if I could darken the whole area, but I guess it's too late.
No, it's fine. You can do that. You're Leroy.
You're also Leroy.
One Leroy is eating a sandwich over by a stand. This is great. I love this. Claudia, you are now almost alone, pretty much entirely alone in a crowd of Leroys.
She's just kind of slowly tiptoe away. Not wanting to be near Leroy.
The further you get away from the epicenter of this event, the more you are seeing Leroys just in the city in different positions at stands, just talking to one another. You see two Leroys making out. In a doorway, you see one Leroy pushing another Leroy and then punching that Leroy. You see a Leroy driving a bus full of Leroy stop, and then Leroy's pile out of the bus. it's really all devolving the entire time. They all also sound like Leroy, no matter what.
At this point, yeah, she's probably booking it. Where? I don't know, but just figuring out an area and going to.
Okay. There is one person that isn't a Leroy that you finally run. You can, like, maybe you go around the corner and you bump into them. It's a bastard. The bastard slowly begins to pull off its helmet. Hey, where are you going? Me?
What?
And then you were Leroy. And the more that this wave spreads out amongst the people, the more that you are seeing that there is just this madness. This thing consuming the world as magnetic waves wash over people and change the way that they think, the way they perceive. Until there is only Leroy anywhere. And throughout the world, people are waking up and feeling their hair is longer, feeling different, speaking differently. There is nowhere to escape. There is nowhere that isn't Leroy. All things are Leroy.
In a forest.
I've lost connection.
Yeah, that's what it said for me too.
Was that on purpose?
Same, I gotta reconnect. Oh my god.
No active game?
No active game, we've killed it.
Yeah, we won.
Oh, we're waking up in a forest! Okay!
Oh my gosh.
This is fine.
Shit, what did the world description say? I forgot to read it.
Oh, I did too.
You waken to the sound of a branch snapping. You are in a forest. The leaves on the ground are wet with rain. Night has fallen, yet you see no moon above. Someone or something is here with you.
Okay. Take a quick 5 to 10 and we will return to this.
What have we done? Okay, be right back.
All right, I'm back whenever other people are. Those of you who are back, if you look at the character selection, you will see that there is a folder called Wanderers. You have a character there. Well, you should. Let me know if anything doesn't work there.
I'm sorry, we should have a what?
You should have a character sheet under the Wanderers folder under the character sheet. The actors.
But we're all named different new things.
Are you?
Well, Wanderers, it's
our disguise people.
Oh, our disguises. Okay.
Yes, you will see that I speak. You will have control of Anastasia Nikolai. Mikey, you have Daniel Rivers. Blue has Regina Romanovna. Enya, you have Rosie Little. And Claudia has Susanna Fisher.
Damn, I just figured that, okay, all right.
Fun.
I think we have everybody back, maybe? Claudia? Susanna? Okay.
I am here.
Alrighty, let me know if anyone has any trouble with their character sheet. But otherwise, welcome to session ?
Am I supposed to do something with the configuration here?
Configuration?
Like it just has the user configuration pop up.
Oh, close it, I guess. Not sure why it popped up for you, but, you know, new Foundry stuff will happen. It's a little weird. You five awaken in a misty forest clearing with mushrooms much larger than should possibly be. This place feels strange and ancient, not like anywhere you've ever been. You are strangers. You know who you are. You don't know who these other people are. They look or seem familiar, but there is something about them that is othering. You have no recollection of how you could have arrived here in this forest, or even what time it is, though night is for certain, as darkness has set down upon this grassy patch between the trees. As you awaken, I will give you each an opportunity to perform one action and one action only that may assist you in whatever it is that is happening here. We will start at the top of the character list. Anastasia, you awaken. You are a doctor from Russia, Vladivostok to be particular. You have been a military doctor and went on to work at a private clinic, and now you are here for some reason. Do you have a partner? Do you have children? Or have you just been living alone?
Oh, this new world?
Yeah.
Maybe she's got a boyfriend at one of the towns, but traveling alone mostly.
Sure, and if he knew where you were, he would probably be in a panic. But you've been in the battlefield before. You know there is no time for panic. So I will need you to give me a roll of your choice that may assist you with your current situation. What is it that you feel a doctor would do right now if they woke up in this field?
Check everyone for injuries.
If everyone allows you, a stranger, to check them for injuries, then that is entirely possible. Is there anyone who feels like their character maybe wouldn't want a stranger poking at them waking up?
I would say I'm a doctor, of course.
All right. If there are no objections to the doctor performing an examination, why don't you go ahead and give me a clever roll? One. There doesn't seem to be, with that result, there doesn't seem to be really anything obviously wrong that you can tell with any of them.
Okay.
But that's because you got a one.
I don't remember how I got here or anything.
No. Right, not particularly. You can try to roll remember if you'd like.
Okay.
Can't remember a thing.
No. I'll ask everyone else if they could remember how we got here. And I guess look around for danger.
Hey guys, the DM crashed.
Oh no.
So this might crash, I guess. Haha. That's okay. The timing sort of checks out.
I just got back. Did we crash?
Yeah.
Our DM crashed, yeah. But we woke up in a forest and we're all different characters.
Yeah, if you remember. I don't know. The name he gave as a disguise and like profession.
Oh, we're just people now.
We're specifically the people we were pretending to be.
Yeah.
Cool.
We just are them now, I guess.
I would assume you're Daniel Rivers.
I think so. It's the one that was highlighted when I got here.
It does say flower child on it and expert botanist. So
this all tracks.
Yeah.
You have lost connection to the server. Yep. There it goes.
There it goes.
See, this is all part of the plan.
Yeah, it's just part of it. Yeah.
Yeah, that's when we smash cut to his computer actually just spitting flames and just like, yep, all according to plan.
This is what happens when you update Foundry.
It really is, though. As someone who also uses Foundry for games, it really is the second you update, you are just welcoming hell.
We also switched, like, entire game system. We shut down one game and opened another game.
This is also true. But I've run one game and watched it die on me.
Oh no.
We noticed that you were playing Fate. Why not play D&D 5e?
Yeah, just no thank you. Wait, where's the X?
why can't I log out?
Welcome back.
I had a little bit of a crash. There might be another one coming. Hopefully not. My system stability's been a little weird lately, but, you know, get through it. Okay, so your medical assessment tells you that there is really nothing so far that you can tell super wrong, is where I was. Daniel, you are a botanist. I believe that you are, let's see.
You are from the United States. Parts unknown. You are someone who has at least a father who taught you how to shoot, and you are no stranger to the outdoors. What is the first thing that you feel like your character would do after the medical treatment and or assessment diagnosis?
What was found out? I wasn't here until I guess it crashed, right when it crashed.
Oh, nothing.
Yeah, we know nothing was
found. Okay, so we don't know.
Nobody knows anything.
Yeah, I guess he would look around then at everyone else. A little confused, because he doesn't. I don't recognize any of them, right?
No, they are strangers to you.
Roll your remember.
You can try to roll your remember if you'd like to use that as your action. Yeah.
Oh yeah, I'll do that.
Okay, a one. You remember something. You remember following somebody and hiding behind a corner. You just really needed to follow them. You hear something rustling in the bushes to your west. Before you choose maybe to investigate that, if you would, or maybe you'd just rather leave it alone, it could be really anything. This is a forest. Though the mushrooms are, you've never seen anything like that. The mushrooms of this size, they're very odd. So that rustling could be an animal. Probably maybe not dangerous. You don't know because you're not familiar with this type of forest. You just know it is a forest.
Okay, but I can see the others who are here.
Yes, you okay. Can see all of them, and then you hear a rustling in the bush, in the brush.
Yeah, if I'm the first one to see that, then I'll like kind of wave to get their attention without saying anything, and then I'll do, you know, like a shushing motion, and then I'll point to where I hear it coming from, and then I'll do kind of like both hands, like lay low.
Okay. So Regina Romanovna, as you are coming to, you get a medical checkup and you can see this guy is like telling people to get down and be quiet because he's pointing to a bush over there. Like everyone else, you don't remember how you got here. You do know who you are. You are a Russian journalist who has gotten involved in maybe one too many risky investigations and has now found yourself very much in trouble. Although checking your bag, or you can at least feel you have some of your belongings, including a flask of fine liquor and a lighter. What is the first action that you will take right now?
I guess she kind of wants to suss out if she can like trust the people she woke up with. So maybe a clever?
Careful, we'll say.
Careful.
I'd say careful. You are looking for reasons to be careful. But you feel like you are unsure of their intention? Unless you'd like to spend a fate point to reroll that?
I'd rather just... Can I do my remember roll as well?
Sure.
Into that.
-2. You just can't remember a thing. So you don't know if you can trust these people, and you can't remember why you got here, unfortunately. Would you at least? Daniel is indicating that there is danger over here. It's somewhere in the brush, in like this area. You guys see those pings, yeah. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's new.
She'll go ahead and like hesitate a second, but then get down like he is telling us to.
All right. So then, Rosie, as you are coming to, you see a woman that looks a little bit suspicious, a medical professional, says she's a doctor, a guy who's saying to get down and keep quiet. You are also not, you aren't a stranger to the great outdoors. You are a land surveyor. You also, it seems like you have some of your tools, but not all of them on you. So the only reason you would have those is if you were on the job, maybe, or something. You were transporting them, maybe going to or from a work site. What is the first thing that you would like to do?
She'd probably want to investigate what the rustling is.
Okay. Go ahead and give me a careful roll. The one.
I'm going to invoke.
Okay. What are you invoking?
Master of the Great Outdoors.
You are a master of the great outdoors, which tells you that, like, if there is something coming, like, maybe you should get, like, maybe sort of in this position right here to get ready to try and catch something if they're going to run out. Because Daniel's on the other side here, so he looks like a pretty big, strong man. Both of you could probably, like, catch something or at least stop something from coming out to attack your group. If they are indeed your group, because you're not sure who these people are. You just know they're people. They all look normal-ish. I mean, for the most part. That's your action?
Yeah.
Okay. And then finally, Susanna. You see a group of people, it seems like, preparing to deal with something that may be coming out of the brush. You are a sort of, I won't call you a guru. Well, I guess you are a bit of a guru. You're a wellness guru. You are from, I believe, Habsburg. You are a locally known, locally treasured individual who always is there with good advice for staying in shape, flexible, and dealing with physical therapy issues through yoga, exercise, healthy eating, that sort of thing. Keeps the mind sharp. Usually what doesn't happen to someone like you is you get amnesia, or at any point you wake up inside of a forest you do not recognize. What is the first thing that you would like to do?
I feel like she would look at everybody, kind of get the vibe and kind of feel it out, and then just kind of, I guess, since they're, are they all looking in one direction, kind of, as a, like, a specific point that they're looking at?
Well, yeah, it seems like their attention seems to be on the brush to the west of Daniel there, to the right of him there.
She probably will kind of, I guess, preemptively, in a way, since everyone's already prepared for it, kind of, I guess, kind of try to goad out whatever is in the brush by, like, throwing something in that general direction. Kind of, like, trying to spook it out,
I guess. Okay. Go ahead and give me a, give me a flashy roll for that.
Okay.
You do hit something. You hear a thud. And you hear,
it's a person.
One of you can go forward to see what it is that's there in the brush if you want, or you can just try to walk around it as a group.
Yeah, I'll go see.
Okay. You should have control over your token. And if you click on it, you should hear ambient sound too.
I just see a black screen, so.
Oh, really?
Yep.
Is that, do all of you just see a black screen?
I'm in a forest clearing. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean,
I was in the forest.
Okay, let me try to refresh. See if I can
fix that for you.
There is some shaking going on, though.
Yeah, you should have token vision.
Okay.
Are you clicking on Susanna's token?
I am back, and I was clicked on her, and then for some reason it just took me to a black screen.
Oh, weird.
Now it's now I can see.
Okay. Well, don't move around too much. This is battle map rules. If you move around too much, you're gonna get fucked up.
Hear the ambient.
We'll see things.
No, you won't see anything. Don't worry. But you will get fucked up. Where did Daniel go? Shit.
He disappeared.
Daniel? I see him. He's off to the left.
Lower. What's going on there, bud?
Why are you over there?
He's running. He's doing a runner.
He decided. I'm not gonna see it. I'm just gonna leave.
Fair enough. I'm just gonna drag him over here. Oh, he disconnected too, I think.
Go.
I mean, if he did, I guess someone else can investigate.
Yes. That is true. Someone else can investigate if he's...
Rosie can go.
Okay. Rosie, as you move over towards the brush, we'll put Daniel right around here. In the brush, you see something in there bleeding now.
Is it a big something?
Oh no, his computer crashed. No, it's not a big something. It's a human-sized something. In fact, the thing that you see there in the brush is Daniel, but it's off. Something about the eyes is different, and the teeth are small and sharp and pointed. This Daniel in the brush hisses at you.
Oh my god. Yeah, she's just gonna jump back.
Alright. Once you do, this Daniel in the brush begins to scratch at the wound that was left by the rock that struck him. It's legal. It's legal to follow. It's legal to watch. That's legal. No law against it. Public space.
Okay.
You. He points at you, Rosie. You.
Yes?
What did you see? Did you see me? You gonna tell the police? There's no law here. There's no law here. He quickly draws a knife from his waist. There's no law here.
Rosie's gonna reach into her tool belt. Easy there. You could just join us, you know.
He looks almost exactly like the man to your left there. They would be brothers or twins, even.
You gonna explain why you look like him?
I don't look anything like him. I don't know what you mean.
Okay, why don't we just calm down and talk about our options here? Do you know what's going on?
He lashes out at you with a knife quickly. Just trying to strike out at anything he can, almost desperately. Give me a quick roll. He does 1 point of stress to you. Maybe a small cut on the arm, but you manage to stop it from doing too much damage, from taking too much damage. The blade feels real, and it's cold into the flesh when it cuts. The blood it draws is warm.
this is not a dream. And this man has a knife and isn't afraid to use it. He aims it towards all three of you that are in front of him.
Back off now! You keep your distance!
Okay, yeah, we could be crazy, but you do realize we could just talk.
He just caught you with a knife. You really gonna have a chat with this man?
Yeah, you're right.
Rosie is no pushover. She is a strong, strong woman who has made a living climbing and basically fighting against nature to provide the very best land surveying services that she possibly can. So you're no soft weight. You're no cupcake. And you've dealt with homeless stragglers out in the woods and wilds that maybe thought they could get the better of you, take your things from you. Maybe leave you as another body without a name or anybody to find them out there in the woods, because you know you've tripped over more than one of those. Over your line of work, you probably see more than most. More than you'd like to.
Does she have any of her rock climbing gear on her?
You have a hammer.
You absolutely have
a hammer.
Alright, this hammer's coming out. She just got cut. This guy's fucking out of his mind. She's not time for this.
Alright. If you'd like to hit him with the hammer, go ahead and roll forceful. The 3. Oof. You hit him. Maybe you didn't intend to, but you hit him right over the middle of his head, center mass. You can hear the crack of a skull as he, much to his surprise, has been brained. His head falls forward, spilling red and bits of white as he topples down into the bushes, spasming until he doesn't. You have murdered this man. Now, it was in self-defense. Anyone could see that. He had a knife, and he didn't leave you many options. But he's dead, and you've never killed anyone before.
Yeah. She's just gonna stare at the body. There's no law here, so any of you others want to try something? I'm already bleeding here.
I'm assuming no one else would try to challenge you, or and does anyone feel like they want to?
I held up my hands. May I inspect the body?
Okay. I'm not sure. Like,
you know what? I do want to know why he looks like him. And she points. If you think that looking at this person is gonna do anything, yeah.
I would kneel down and attempt... Well, I'd make sure he was dead first.
He is definitely dead. Yeah, he is very dead.
And then I would... see if he's... like, a general... Like, is he a normal person?
He is, as far as you can tell, a normal person. It looks like he... Now that you have a closer look at him... he's a spitting image of Daniel. There are details about him that are off. He looks malnourished. His fingernails are dirty, so it looks like he's been digging around in the ground. He has a camera on him, but it looks like broken probably before all this. He also has a couple
halfback's note in his pocket and a small map to go with it.
Does the map... Okay, so I guess I start grabbing some of his things. Does the map have anything marked on it?
It does. It's very crudely drawn. Seems like it was done with either dirt or some kind of coal or mud. It generally guides north in a sort of winding direction. But other than that, that is like the map. It just has an X at the end of it. The note that he left says this. That is what the note says, and that is really the information you've gotten here. Yes, for Mikey, Rosie gave your doppelganger a smack on the head with a hammer and killed him in one hit.
Pretty hardcore. I was going to say, do we pass the note around?
Oh, that's up to the doctor.
I'm sorry, what? Do we make him a grave?
Oh, no, I was going to say, yeah, I was asking you if you pass the note around or let us know what it says.
Oh, yes, she'll give us the map to, well, Rosie's already threatened us with a hammer, not exactly, but she has a bloody hammer. I'm not about to not pass out the things, but there's a map and the note. And then I start, like, just gingerly putting this body in a more respectful pose, I guess.
Regina is gonna confront Daniel and say, "Who was that guy? Is that your twin or something?"
I don't know. I don't have a twin. I mean, I guess I kinda do now, but no, that ain't anybody I know. And I don't know anything about this either. Graveyard. I take a look around. There's nothing here that indicates that this is the graveyard.
No. According to the map, if you were to follow it, it looks like wherever you are is probably somewhere in the south end of the trail. The graveyard would be all the way to the north.
Yeah, if that's the case, then he would probably point and just go, I mean, we should probably head there, right? I mean, either he came from there, or he was looking ahead that way, too. Right? I mean, I don't know. Maybe y'all know something, but I don't just know anything about nothing. Do we know each other? Or...
Daniel, you actually... Now that you look at this man, you know him. You recognize him. It's not just that he looks like you. You know him because he's a stalker. You saw him around your neighborhood, maybe, or at a place of work, somebody you knew. This guy followed people obsessively. Didn't stalk you, just people you cared about. He was a scumbag. The question is, should he have died like this in this forest?
Did he always look kind of like a weird version of me, or is that just something that's kind of dawning?
Maybe, yeah, like maybe you're just realizing it. Like, he did kind of look like you.
Yeah, I guess there's a slow recognition. Then he goes, actually, hang on. Yeah. No, I know this. I know this guy. He's like a stalker. He was always running around and, you know, following folk. And, I mean, it was already bad enough. He looked kind of like me, so I was catching shit for it. But, yeah, no, he was weird. I mean, this was kind of his MO, but not the knife. kind of nonsense. I'll, you know, that's new.
Well, will you be going to the graveyard?
I mean, if we don't know where else we're going, I mean, we got a map and we know, again, either he went there looking for someone, maybe even me, shit, or he went there and came this way on somebody's instruction. It's worth looking at. We ain't got real much else.
Yeah, I'm damn curious. Even though I think he was crazy.
Regina, I'm going to give you a compel right now. You're suspicious of betrayal, and this guy just gave a really fishy story about how this guy that looks like him is like a known stalker. Just popped out of nowhere in the forest with a knife. That really is weird. That's very suspicious. You may want to keep a closer eye on not just him, but the rest of these people. Yeah, of course you know it.
Yeah, I was already thinking, she's like, this is not cool. What's the fuck is going on?
Okay, I'll give you another fate point. If you try to get some distance from them, because this is really upsetting, actually. This person just got hit in the head with a hammer. Looks like another guy. You don't know what the fuck this is, and you don't know who these people are. You don't even know where you are.
Okay, I'm gonna, could she kind of like, she'd be like, yeah, I'll go to the graveyard with you, but kind of slowly start walking kind of far behind them to keep an eye or something. Sure. Yeah.
Okay. Then I'm going to assume maybe your cohorts have a map and a note, and no other indication of where they are or where they should be going other than the graveyard. Susanna, this is not normal, and you are not used to the situation. You're probably not even, like, the most outdoorsy you ever probably got was, like, maybe a hike or, like, you know, you like the park, but being trapped in a forest with a bunch of people and now somebody being dead on the ground is a lot. You also, you have your kids to think about, your children. Do you feel like your character would feel safe traveling with these strangers after you've just seen them murder somebody? Susanna? Susanna.
Claudia.
Yeah. A new name, Claudia.
Hello. Oh, hi. Sorry.
I was wondering, do you think Claudia would, or Susanna here, would feel, like, what is her general feeling here right now?
She's kind of suspicious of these two. Like, I mean,
okay,
but she does kind of believe it. Does kind of believe he's all right. I mean, he seems to be telling the truth so far. So, but she is kind of not sure totally yet. Like, I'm not sure how I would glean any more information since one guy's dead.
Yeah.
And the other guy is telling, like, his story. So.
All right. So you guys can move your tokens around.
Hey, he crashed again.
No!
Oh, no.
Well, time to explore while he's got now. Kidding.
Quick!
Look at all the corners! Yeah, ruin the surprises!
trick ruin all the surprises the DM has carefully prepared for us over the course of several days.
Painstakingly, yeah, assembled before us in a whole new game system.
I went to the trouble of making a battle map at all. And there it goes.
Aha, uh-huh. I'm back. Sorry about that. Got another crash. I guess my stability, when I was setting everything up, I didn't have this many issues, so I'm not sure what that's about.
Does this imply it's something wrong with Discord?
No, I don't think so. Probably not. That would be a pain in the ass. Again? Oh goodness. I'm gonna give this maybe one more shot, and then between all these like technical difficulties, it may be better to make this a two-parter.
All those magnetic waves made all our computers Leroy. I don't know what you want.
Obviously. That's fine. It would give me more time to work on stuff anyway. So I wouldn't necessarily complain. But for now, we'll just run it until I hit another crash, maybe, and hopefully get it a little bit moved forward. Let me change a thing and see if that helps. Also, I can't believe Mikey's having problems, too. Jeez.
Everyone, yeah. Everyone tonight.
I think it's sympathetic crashing.
He's not actually crashing, he's just crashing in sympathy.
Yeah, to make me feel okay. Thanks, Mikey. All right. Let me, I guess, go forward with a little bit of what's going on here. So for you, Susanna, you said that you're not exactly, you don't have a lot to like investigate here in terms of documents. That is true. But you never know what you'll be able to find. If this guy had notes on him, maybe you'll be able to find other notes or maps or traces that people have left here in the forest. And there's this aching suspicion within you that there is some reason that you're here, some kind of thing, somewhere you might have gone wrong or something. So if you're there, and I have reopened the foundry, by the way, so you might need to reload. But if and when you do return, go ahead and give me a remember roll. If you're even, I don't even see you actually on the user list. So.
Okay, the game's actually back.
Yeah.
Mine just
loaded in. You want a remember roll?
If you could, yes.
Okay.
The two. There is something here in this forest that is of great importance, but more importantly, you remember that there is a song that you like. What is the song that you like? What is a song you like?
as Susanna. You are a fan of the classics.
I guess I would say a Tchaikovsky kind of affair. I don't know any of the song in my head. So, maybe I'll look one up real quick, but, I think it's called March or something.
March?
March. I think it's called March Slave. Or March of the Toy Soldiers, one of the two. That's what Google tells me.
Okay, so you like the March of the Toy Soldiers. Yes, that is like, you. For some reason, it comes to mind that you like that song. Something about it resonates with you. Is it the playfulness of the arrangement? The very exciting but not completely overstated instrumentation, the balance of instruments done therein? Is it the speed or the tempo that is truly something that captures your attention and imagination? Or is it just because it's a holiday classic, something that you remember warmly and fondly from your time with your family? Who can say? The song is enchanting regardless. The more that you think about that song, the more you swear you can hear it. In your head, maybe. At first, no. But then the rest of you hear it. Slowly. And then you can hear something from the brush to your left, to the over here. Before you know it, Susanna, you are set upon by what your own doppelganger.
Oh.
Tries to grab you up.
She just fucking grabs a stick and swings back at her.
Sorry, I had a bit of lag.
Hello?
There we go. Yes, this woman has tried to grab you and she's screaming into your face, throttling you hard. Go ahead and give me a... Well, you have a stunt here. Get down. But I would say give me your own forceful roll.
Okay.
So you're kind of on equal footing with this woman as she's grabbing you and trying to scream in your face. You can feel the spittle from her mouth. There is almost like mint mouthwash or something. Like she just brushed her teeth before she came out here. And worst of all, her singing actually isn't that bad, despite your DM's inability to sing. It's actually quite heavenly. Unfortunately, it's also in your face, and you can practically smell the blood on her breath from the furious gnashing that she's had about her teeth on her tongue and the inside of her cheek, some of which is bitten, and you can clearly see now that you are close enough to her mouth. Like a rabid animal, she is attempting to scream this music at you. What do you want to do here to deal with this?
I really just want to kind of grab her and in a kind of judo throw move. Or like a not judo throw, but kind of like a Brazilian, just kind of lock her neck down in a kind of arm bear or something kind of stupid.
We'll say maybe you saw something on TV. You're just a yoga mom. Well, maybe you took a self-defense class down at the Y or something. Go ahead and give me a forceful roll for that, for putting her in a chokehold or arm bar. Yeah, you are not. This is not Claudia.
Yeah, I know. I just wasn't.
She overpowers you as you attempt to get the chokehold on her. You can call for help from one of the people around you to try and assist you, as this woman is clearly going to maybe start biting your face off if she manages to get her mouth close enough to it. There is time for maybe one of them to spring into action, and the two closest really are Regina and Anastasia in the very split second here that you have. Who would you like to pass initiative to?
I think she's gonna who are you? And it's her with Regina behind her or whatever. Help me. Get this thing off of me.
Regina, this is just apparently, you know, you may be suspicious, but this is just a normal woman being attacked by her double, just like the Daniel situation. What would you like to do here to try and help this woman?
Yeah, she'll be pretty like, oh shit. And oh man, I set this person on fire.
I don't know if you want to do that while she's trying to grapple with
Okay. Maybe I'll try to just throw splash bourbon in her face. Oh no, did you crash again?
No, I didn't crash. Okay. I'm just not projecting. Got some lag. That's okay.
What did you say?
Okay, there we go. I'm sorry. So, yes, what is it? You can't. I don't know if setting her on fire is a good idea. You might set.
No, I was thinking of splashing bourbon in her face. Or, oh yeah, I could hit her with the bottle.
Okay, you want to hit her with the bottle, but you maybe don't want to break it. So, we'll see how that goes. Okay. Well, maybe you don't care if you break it or not. Go ahead and give me a forceful roll. One. Oh. If you spend a fate point, you can KO her. You don't have to kill her, but you can KO her. Or you can kill her if you want.
Could I knock her unconscious?
Sure. If you spend a fate point, you absolutely will.
Okay. I will invoke tough skin.
Yeah, you're a hardened. You're no slouch at combat either. You've been in a scrap or two. You get a solid hit in on this woman as she's screaming, and then she just goes down. There's blood everywhere, just like with Daniel, but not quite as messy. Not quite as many brains spilling out. Susanna, by the time you get out from under this woman's grip, you can see a few things. You know her. You know this woman. You know her from, like, you went to school with her. Everyone always said you two looked alike. And she was a good singer, but she also, like, just used her position and her good looks and her singing ability to get advantages she didn't deserve. Something of a siren. Destructive at that. If she's here, there must be a reason, but it's hard to tell. She's been knocked out, so she can't really answer questions. It's only you can't remember her name quite. Something. Maybe something like your name.
Oh, God. Thank you, whoever you are.
I'm Regina.
Susanna.
So you have a twin too, huh?
I don't have a twin. I think she's from a school I attended way back. I can't remember her name for the life of me, though. It's on the tip of my tongue.
So there are multiple stalkers?
It would seem so.
I am starting to think this is unnatural.
There is something very unnatural about it. You can hear someone else dragging their way up the road. Footsteps in the darkness. Now multiple footsteps.
I think we should get out of the forest.
No, we should confront them this time. We're expecting 4 more ambushes at this rate. You want to just put your back to them?
I was thinking more like maybe finding a bit somewhere that isn't open?
A woman steps forward as you're discussing this. She looks an awful lot like Rosie, with a hatchet in hand and blood on her hands. She looks at the fallen, unconscious Susanna, or at least whoever that is, and then back at your group. Found another one, huh? Another one. It's about 130, 140 pounds. She grabs the Susanna by the ankle. You salt it. Bury it. When the winter comes, you've got enough. No reason to let it go to waste. She starts to drag the body away from your group. You weren't going to do anything with this, were you?
Oh my god.
Are you talking about cannibalism?
Of course not. No reason to call it that.
Who the hell are you?
I'm just someone who lives out here in the woods. I do what I can to get by. I don't let anything go to waste. Plant, animal, whatever. And this is an animal that I have here. She drags the body a little bit further away from you.
Wait, please. Do you know anything about the graveyard?
I don't go to the graveyard. There's no reason for me to go to the graveyard. She smiles. There's a lot of you here. I wonder what happens when one of you gets hungry. Don't try to eat these mushrooms. They'll kill you. But this animal that I found, this carcass, this is safe. You cook it enough and it's safe to eat.
As a wellness instructor, I have to advise against that. Because it's still a human body.
It is still alive.
Yes, it's... Think of all the sanitary problems. And she just kind of waves her hands in front of her like, ugh.
Salt, you say?
That's right. The best rock salt you can buy from the general store. By the pound, enough to put into the back of your pickup. That way, when you drive out into the woods and have a camping trip, you're never unprepared for what you run into. Elk, bear, salmon, monkey. She kicks the body a little. Any animal at all. Skin them, get rid of the hair, bleed them out, cut off really good chops of what you can get. But I wouldn't recommend the organs. I wouldn't recommend the organs of the animal, of the ape.
That's so disgusting.
Why not bring some hot dogs to cook at the campfire?
If you have a general store, why not just go get, like, small snacks or foods? Or, like, I don't know. I mean, surely there's something better than this. Because you even mentioned elk and food, which is all fine. I get that if you're all surviving. But this is a person. You can't just eat people.
Oh no.
What?
But, by the way, the DM crashed again.
Oh no!
Amazing.
Cannibalism ended the DM's career.
He says yes, it's true. Oh man. I mean, it's not like Mikey came back, so.
No, Mikey's back. Oh no, Mikey's only back in the chat.
I was gonna say, can you guys hear me? It's gonna sound real bad because I'm on my laptop trying to.
Yeah. Yeah, we can hear you. Kind of.
You're just very quiet.
You sound like a. You sound like a tiny robot trapped in a computer box.
Hi, Veloso!
Baseball. Yeah.
Hi, Palazzo, do you like baseball?
No! Oh, dear.
Blue screens for everyone.
This is what happens when you update Foundry.
Leroy, what have you done?
Your computer from the inside.
Like Icarus, we flew too close.
Yeah, it might be time to just
I've also got a blue screen, and I'm trying to fix it.
Oh, this Foundry is causing blue screens today?
I don't think it's Foundry, because the error that it came up with, I was looking it up, and it looks like it's part of, like, some Windows 10 update that came through. Like, a lot of people are getting the file corrupted when it's installing, and then it tries to run the file to, like, confirm it for you, and then when you do that, it goes, oh, the file's corrupted, and it crashes, and then it tries to fix the corrupted file, but it just keeps putting in the corrupted file.
Oh, I actually had that update queued, and my computer was like, we can't install it. So, I feel like I talked to Bully.
I'm scared now. Oh, no.
Hello. I'm on my tablet because my computer crashed.
So this is a battle of robot voice?
Yeah.
We're all Palazzo.
In this blessed day, we are all Palazzo.
Do you like baseball?
I want everybody to cannibalize everybody else.
That doesn't sound like Palazzo.
I like, somebody mentioned hot dogs. They serve those at baseball games. Mm-hmm. You don't know what they're made out of.
I feel like they would not be made out of people.
Do I sound horrible? Is that what's up? I bet I do.
You just sound like a little tinny, but it's not like terrible. Yeah.
Like how Mikey sounds, you sound.
This is the first time I've gotten this kind of crash. I don't know what the fuck that is. Like, it usually just crashes and restarts. Doesn't do a whole scan. But I am going to say that because of technical difficulties, we should either delay this till Sunday or next Thursday.